2018, GSL Season 1, CODES, Daybreak. Live from Free Cup Studio in Seoul, this is the GSL. Yeah!
What's up? It's time for another day of the GSL CODES. We've got a serious kick-ass group. It's good to be back with you all. And we've got some all-star players playing today.
Oh, we certainly do. A rematch of a BlizzCon Finals could occur tonight.
That's right.
A lot of people are thinking that it will. In fact, Dark and Bjorn both in this group. But do not underestimate their Protoss opponents.
That's right.
Nor any Protoss opponents. No, but Trap is legit always underestimated. Yep. A very strong player indeed.
Well, Trap's somebody who's been a little bit overshadowed by some of these other Protoss players that have been more dominant. But before we talk about that, here's what our schedule is going to look like. We've had to move some days around.
So, Wednesday next week, we are starting an hour and a half early.
Yes.
So mark your calendars. The group nominations would be that night.
We got the group nominations. That's right. IM Pyeongchang is going to be occurring through the 5th to the 7th. We will be there for that. When we come back, we'll be going into the round of 16, Group A, as well as Group B on Wednesday at the usual time. Now, there is Lunar New Year out here. For those of you who are in the States and aren't familiar with other global holidays, this is one of the biggest holidays in Korea. So we will not have any broadcasts on that Saturday, but we'll be back to work the following week on the 21st, and things should be occurring at our normal scheduled times at 6:30 p.m. on Wednesday and 1 o'clock p.m. on Saturday, Korean time.
Yeah, Lunar New Year is such a big holiday over here in general, you know, big in all these countries over in this area of the world. And truthfully, when you think about it, solar years are kind of like dumb, right? Like the sun is so far away, we're never even going to land on it. We've been to the moon. We're bros to the moon. The moon controls our tides. The lunar year makes a lot more sense to me, Tasteless.
I agree.
Yeah.
It's kind of weird being out here during Lunar New Year in Korea because everything is closed, with few exceptions. So
it's one of the two big holidays.
If you're a non-Korean out here during then, definitely be ready. Stock some food up. Know the places that are open, so if you need to go out and eat, you can, because that's one of the big expat shocks, is when you get out here and discover nothing is open, and you got to rearrange your whole life around that. Anyways, here are the players that have advanced so far to the round of 16.
Yes, as you can see, Taren's actually doing quite well here so far. A lot of top guys getting through. We'll see if another in Bjorn can get through tonight. It's not going to be too easy, to be honest. Like, this is a very tough group. Trust, specifically, is quite good at PBT. I've always really appreciated his PBT above his other matchups, so we'll see.
So, 2017년에 제가 그렇다의 성적을 못 내가지고 좀 많이 아쉬웠는데 2018년에는 꼭 우승할 수 있도록 우승도 하고 싶고 그럴 만한 실력을 가졌다고 생각하고 있어서 좀 설레요.
2017년부터 제가 좀 연습을 소홀히 했던 게 좀 아쉬웠던 것 같고 너무 빨리 지나간 것 같아요. 이번에 예선을 통과한 순간부터 이제 좀 더 마음가짐이 바뀌어서 더 열심히 해야 될 것 같아요.
제가 되게 어렸을 때부터 게임을 시작했는데 이제 20살이 넘어가고 나서 한 살 한 살 먹을 때마다 저의 시간이 얼마 남지 않았다라는 생각이 들어요. 그리고 작년에는 거의 저는 아무것도 한 게 없다고 생각하기 때문에 올해는 좀 간절해요.
일단 작년 2017년에는 첫 시즌에 너무 빨리 떨어졌어요. 그래서 이번 첫 시즌에는 좀 많이 올라가도록 해야 될 것 같아요.
우리 중 왜 세 명밖에 없지라는 생각을 좀 했던 것 같아요. 토스밖에 없어가지고 좀 쉽게 올라가겠다라는 생각을 했었는데 테란을 좀 원했는데 테란이 없더라고요. 그게.
일단은 대진표를 봤을 때 제 조만 먼저 봤거든요. 근데 좀 되게 힘들겠다 생각했는데 다른 조도 보니까 다 비슷하더라고요. 다 힘들고. 그래서 저는 그냥 받아들이고 있어요, 지금.
아프리카 측에서 왜 나한테 왜 이러지? 라는 생각이 들었어요. 만났던 상대를 자주 붙여주시는 것 같아요. 또 그 선수들이 쉬운 상대도 아니고 그래서.
일단 박영호 선수가 눈에 띄긴 했는데 아마 조 상태를 보니까 저랑 박영호 선수랑은 못 만날 것 같기도 하고 그리고 요즘 프로토스가 되게 강하잖아요. 그 프로토스가 저희 조에 두 명이나 있다는 게 좀 너무 무서워요.
현우 형이 저를 못 만날 것 같다고 뭐 평소에 저한테도 얘기하는데 현우 형이 지금 자신의 위치를 잘 알고 있는 것 같아서 좀 마음속으로 좀 뿌듯하고 그 형이 좀 열심히 했으면 좋겠어요.
2018년 새해에는 좀 더 열심히 준비하고 더 멋진 모습 보여드릴 테니까 응원 많이 해주셨으면 좋겠습니다.
GSL에서 더 좋은 성적 거두면서 이제 경기도 많이 하고 꼭 블리즈컨에도 갈 수 있도록 하겠습니다.
작년에는 좀 아깝게 포인트가 부족해가지고 블리즈컨을 가지 못했는데 이번 연도에는 첫 시즌부터 포인트를 좀 많이 따놔가지고 아 포인트가 아니라 그냥 우승해서 직행권을 따고 시작했으면 좋겠습니다. 따고 시작하도록 노력해 보도록 하겠습니다.
저를 평소에 응원해 주시는 팬분들 새해 복 많이 받으시고요. 그리고 2018년의 목표는 그냥 2016년 박명호보다 두세 배 열심히 해서 더 좋은 모습을 보여주자라는 생각으로 지금 연습을 하고 있으니까요. 많은 기대해 주시고 봐주시면 감사하겠습니다.
Interview. Bjorn makes a very good point. He was slow to get a lot of points early on in the year in 2017 and wasn't able to play catch up. The real story of last year was Rogue, who barely eked in.
Yeah.
But of course, I think even Rogue last year would not have wanted to earn his points the way he had. I guess it's a better story for him. But ideally, yeah. If you want to get to the BlizzCon WCS Global Finals, you want to try to get as many points everywhere at all times and be as consistent as possible. And I think Bjorn coming into season one of 2018 in the GSL Codas is certainly going to do his very best to try to do that and be an overall more well-rounded, successful player.
Yeah, and those early seeds. Let's not forget actually how TY approached last year. It was actually quite hilarious. Like, he had a good year in the tournaments he played in, but he won Katowice very early and secured his BlizzCon spot. And then he did not even try to qualify for half the tournaments in Korea. The guy was not even trying out for SSL. Like, it was kind of funny because he's just like, well, I'm already in BlizzCon. You know, I'm playing GSL. I'm good.
Yeah.
But anyways, looking at this group, Bjorn says he wants to win and Trap really wants to get to BlizzCon. Trust says, I'll try to play well. Please support me.
Trust, especially going into this group, he's aware of where he is on the tier list. He's right at the bottom, at least in this group. He's obviously a very successful player. We do have breakout players every year. We certainly saw that with Gumiho. Not that he was, I say, at the caliber we'd put at Trust, but a breakout player in the sense that he became a CODES champion. Trust has to make a splash this year.
Yeah.
And we'll see how he does starting 2018 in this group, but it's going to be very, very difficult. I expect Trust to be knocked out first.
Yeah, I would expect that as well. We'll see if he can make some upsets. You know, I feel like he is the person most affected. His career trajectory, rather, is the one that is most affected by the Kespa breakup. Before Kespa broke up, this guy was on a team with Stats and Zest, and I was calling him Mini Zest at the time because he just was like a little tiny carbon copy of Zest. He looked like him with the same dyed hair and glasses, and then he played the same builds, and like he did a good job, but then, you know, that went away, and he's had a hard time since then. So I'm not feeling like he's going to make it tonight, Tasis. Let's find out. Daybreak. When the lights come out. Crazy to think that this player right here was actually the Zerg for, I'd say, the first three-fourths of 2017. Yeah.
That he was basically the best Zerg from A to Z. Sue was always there as well, but, you know, Dark, I think, was more rising up. But during the end of 2017, it was Rogue that just shot through the ranks exponentially and managed to become the very best in the whole world. So I'm curious to see how Dark is going to be approaching this year, because that has to be a very odd feeling to suddenly, rapidly be displaced like that by someone of your same race.
Yeah, I know what you mean. Because it's like, him and Sue have been the best two Zergs in the world for a long time. And occasionally, I feel like Bill pops his head up. From time to time, Solar's like, don't forget about me!
Right.
But yeah, it's kind of been the way of it. You know, Dark has always just been showing ridiculous games. And of course, Rogue right now is just unfathomably good.
Yeah.
Of course, maybe not having the greatest first season. But, I don't know. He says he's going to practice harder than the year where he got second place at BlizzCon and was really impressive. 2 to 3 times harder, in fact.
I suppose in some ways, Rogue's results previously in the GSL Codex could be very encouraging to Dark. Like, okay, maybe he's just a flash in the pan here. Mm. Viva Dark. Some Dark support.
Oh,
nice drawing,
cool.
too. Yeah.
Yeah, that's like a queen holding Roman numeral 2.
Exactly.
For StarCraft 2. Or the second coming of Dark, perhaps.
Yeah. Or 2 glasses of milk. I mean, we don't even know.
Yeah, it could be.
And art is open to interpretation. I mean, it really just depends.
Yeah.
Whatever meaning you can get out of it, Artosis.
So,
Stargate opening here.
Yeah, kind of what you would expect. I'm not sure how Truss is going to approach this series to try and take it. We haven't seen like a ton of Truss success recently. So, I don't know, man. I'm like hoping that he can just show us some quality plays, some good games. Looks like a Roach Warren coming out of Dark rather quickly here. It's probably just a safety Warren, if I had to guess.
It'd be cool if he tried to do something aggressive with it.
Do you think he'd get aggressive here against Trust?
I don't know. I think normally it would be a safety Warren, but you never know with Dark. He actually has been historically off and on super aggressive.
Yeah,
he's aggressive. Actually works more than it doesn't work with him. But let's see. You know, we were talking about a lot of these players, you know, who have not gotten a Roach Warren at all. To deal with certain types of attacks. I think Roachhorn is sort of an all-around safety tech is one way to look at it. If you have a Roachhorn, there's a lot of things that cannot kill you.
Yeah.
Or at least even the option, the availability of roaches. Well,
this is not a safety Warren at all. 8 roaches being made.
Yep.
And an evolution chamber. So we're going to see some drop lords coming out. Speed just finished. No, the scouting of Trust so far, it's like not that good. He's seen a few lings. He's seen 6 lings. There's nothing too unordinary about that.
What's so good about this build, and you can see it unfolding right before us, is that the moment it's scouted, the build has already been activated.
Yeah.
There's basically no prep time. Maybe just a little bit. Like, you know, 10, 12 seconds for Protoss to try to come up with something.
God.
While Lings are going to be dropped into the main, Roaches are going to come here into the front. And I don't know if the drones are going to be killed here is going to be enough to curb the damage that Dark certainly can do.
Well, actually,
that's a lot of kills. Okay, I'm sorry, guys.
That's a huge amount of kills.
I jumped the shark there, but before all those drones were killed.
Yeah.
Okay, but here comes the attack. And this is actually enough to completely KO Protoss, and Protoss doesn't handle it perfectly.
Yeah, he's not really defending as quickly as he needed to here.
Morphing in the injured Roach into a Ravager. Not unpowering quite that Robo. With a Ravager down here, I think there's just too much damage output. Ling spilling in. It's 36 probes killed to the 7 drones we saw earlier, and that's going to be it. GG. Dark takes game one.
Okay, so a swift victory from Dark, staying on his aggressive roots. I have to be critical for a moment here. At the indecision of Trust.
Yeah.
His Oracle flew in, saw the Roach Warren, and turned around immediately. I think he saw the Evolution Chamber as well, but I'm not certain. So let's just go with the Roach Warren. His Oracle turned around, started going home, then turned around. By the way, that was a completely empty mineral line, so if he was going to attack, that was a great time. That was a great place. He could have killed more than the 7 drones ago at the natural, but the thing is, he turned around and then came back. So first off, that's indecisive. Second off, you see a Roach Warren that early?
Yeah.
I don't think anyone's going to fault you for chrono boosting out of Void Ray immediately. That Void Ray started a little bit late. Like, he didn't fully wall. If you're getting all in, man, if there's actually an attack coming, wall everything. Don't sit your Adepts out front. They want to kill your Adepts. They're going to fight your Adepts no matter what. Put them behind a wall.
Once the entrance has been breached, Protoss oftentimes has only a few seconds to try to stabilize, or the game ends almost immediately. And that's what we saw there. You're totally right. The Adepts were not in a good position. There was no Void Ray coming back. I think sending the Oracle home, maybe. That could have helped out as well. Oracles can certainly shave down Lings, which are usually what is reinforcing that, since they can move across the map more quickly.
Yeah.
The Ravager wasn't done. There was no anti-air. Not that a Ravager really counters an Oracle. But, you know, there's ways that Trust could have handled that better. GSL. Anyways, let's go to game number two.
Codas, Daybreak. When the lights come out.
I do like that really aggressive play by him early on.
Dark.
Just coming in. Not that Trust is a rookie player, but you could definitely throw somebody off, especially the first game in a studio match like this, just getting in their face like that.
Yeah. Very true about that.
Trust.
You know what's kind of funny, actually? Just complete aside, I was playing some StarCraft 2 this morning on stream.
Yeah.
I haven't been playing too much lately, but they have the new maps and all that. Very excited to kind of get back into it. Now that the meta's kind of settled a bit and I can steal builds. But all my PVZs were against that build this morning.
Oh, really? The Roach, the Roach
like,
Ling drop?
Hey, Roaches! Like, yeah. Here's a Ling drop! And yeah, just kind of interesting that it seems to be maybe a little bit in style at the moment. I'm not sure, but...
Well, I guess if... I mean, you know, teching into an Oracle, it has a lot of different functions. One of those functions is scouting. The other is, of course, harassing and... It's got utility later on to tag certain groups of units, but if you just take the scouting portion of it, by the time you get there, it's almost too late. The rush is already
it's
so
on its way.
Inbound.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You got to take drastic measures against something like that. And if you don't see the Roaches, you know, you could be like, does he think I'm all in on him? I don't know.
Yeah.
But, you know, one of the reasons why I think rushes like that can work pretty well. Is that people don't sacrifice the Adept. They kind of poke in. It's got 4 vision on the Shade now, right? So you kind of see things. But Dark keeps chasing the Shade with his 6 Lings. And Trust is just like, I don't want to lose this, right? So he gets the Scout off only when the Oracle gets there. Like, for instance, if he... Let's say he sacrifices the Adept. Or he gets it in there and he tries to play a little bit... You know, play a little bit quickly. Like, try to... dodge away from the Lings, maybe kite the Lings, kill some Lings off with it, you know, at least trade it somewhat. If he sees this coming, you hold it easily if you just attack the units with the Oracle on their way over.
Right.
You shave off all the Lings in like 2 seconds. You, if there's a Ravager, you kill it.
Exactly.
You know, Oracles deal damage really quickly. So, anyways, it's just kind of an interesting little change that we've seen here.
You know, it does make me curious how long, for instance, we'll see a build like this from Dark, or just Zerg players in general as this season and this year go on, because sometimes builds can become super trendy just because people haven't quite gotten used to them yet.
Yeah, totally.
And once they get used to them, you discard them right away. Yeah. But this was a great opening here for Dark. And like Trust is going to be feeling the stress. When you think of how much you practice as a pro gamer for all sorts of situations, and a lot of them are late game, a lot of them are early game, to just get punted into game 2.
Yeah.
That fast.
I like it punted.
Yeah.
But that's
psychologically that will affect you for sure. And I think that also might have been part of Dark's game plan, or at least an added bonus of doing this.
So, this is a truly quick layer here with a Roach Warren and an Evolution Chamber by Dark. So, not 100% sure of what he's planning.
Can I jump in here for a second? I do want to point out there are 2 Protosses in this group, and I think Trust is the weaker of the 2 Protosses.
Oh, for sure, yeah.
So maybe, perhaps, Dark is playing a very unique style that he will not use against Trap later on, assuming he has to fight Trap.
Yeah.
Dark may be covering all his bases. He did say... in his interview, and I'm taking him at his word, that he was going to be very prepared this year for 2018 and really try to dominate. And it seems like, if I'm not reading too much into it, he's already showing exactly that, because I think we're not going to see these openers against Trap at all.
I would agree with
you on
that.
Assuming they play.
Almost certainly. Trap is... He has, like, quietly been one of the stronger PvZ players in the world since Heart of the Swarm. And he's been probably the most underrated top Korean Protoss for that entire period. Like, no one ever talks about Trap, but he causes more upsets than almost anyone. And when you cause more upsets than almost anyone,
Are they upsets? I was about to say that. Like, we might say, oh, wow, that's surprising. I really thought, for instance, Trap would lose to Dark. But then you have to go back and say, well, wait a minute. Is it that we only mentally have so much space for the number one Protosses in the world that we can hold at one time?
Yeah.
Is that what it is? Because really, most of the time if Trap wins a game, it's not really that much of an upset, you know?
Yeah, it's like,
it's
oh,
not
yeah,
like if
Trap
Lucira takes out, I don't know, name but Beyond or something like that.
Yeah,
where
like
we'd
an
say,
or,
yeah, yeah, wow, that's crazy. But yeah, I think that's something worth noting there with Trap.
It's kind of interesting. Now, I do want to say I am a gigantic fan of the way that Trust has decided to play this. He's going Phoenix Colossus right now, a truly old build. But based on what he scouted two base Lair and then went directly into Colossus tech before his third. I think that this was strategically perfect. Like, no matter what Dark is doing at that point, you're safe. You are not going to die. You're going two base Colossus. He can do a Hydra build. He can try for drops. He can go Mutas. It doesn't matter. You've countered absolutely everything. So
Is the third safe, no matter what? Because that's worth noting there is he's going to get both those sentries. I don't know if the body block is going to be efficient enough to keep the Colossus. Actually, I'm sorry. Maybe he will hold this expansion. He's doing a good job with these Zealots, soaking up some of this damage. I guess the Phoenixes can't clean up the rest.
He's going to be a little bit careful with these speed roaches kind of chasing down. Colossus don't have that much damage against roaches anymore. Look at these hilarious phoenixes. Everything's so red. Still trying to micro here. Now, the one thing is, like, okay, yeah, he's delaying this. He doesn't look like he's going to end up killing a Colossus. But this entire time, Dark was really low on drones. Like, he was at 52-ish drones that entire time. So I still look at this and say, okay, I'm totally cool with where Trust is at. Like, I think that, you know, obviously I'm still thinking that Dark will probably win this game, but I think that Trust has dealt with everything quite well so far.
You know, Trust is definitely, I think, responding to this, like you were saying, in the right way. And really, when you saw those roaches come up there, it's okay to lose the Zealots, especially sentries. In an ideal game, you never want to lose them. But only really taking the shields off that one Colossus, and he can keep pumping out more Robo units. We see a War Prism on the way. I believe I saw earlier he had an Immortal down there, too. He's getting enough Robo tech that the current tech here from Dark, which is Hydras and Roaches, the Immortal answers the Roaches pretty well, as well as just Girth in front of Colossus.
Oh, yeah.
Help out. But then he's got he has an Immortal there. Oh, yeah, I'm sorry. It's right beneath the leg of the Colossus on the right.
It looks like he just wants to sit on two Colossus for now.
Right. Well, that's enough to handle a small amount of Hydras, which we just saw there. And, of course, having that Immortal out, now that I confirm that I saw it, I'm not crazy, that's going to be enough to handle a small amount of Roaches. So, overall, I think Trust is actually in really good shape in this game, and I think this push coming out here, assuming it's executed well and angled well, is going to be hard for Dark to deal with.
Yeah, it's kind of a cool comp. Interesting to see that he's going into Lurkers. Lurkers, you know, you can micro Colossus to kill Lurkers technically, but it's not worth your time. The Phoenixes, on the other hand, are really quite good against Lurkers. Just picking them up and dropping them, you know, pop them out of the ground. Is quite a good move. He loses quite a few of those, unfortunately.
Yeah, but Phoenix count is low enough. They're not going to be as helpful here. Another Phoenix goes down, so it's just one here. Final targeting on that Phoenix.
Yeah. A lot of damage by those Lurkers onto the Stalkers. Stalkers so bad against Lurkers.
Oh, yeah.
But look, this is the kind of tricky thing where it's like, okay, the Colossus can walk in, hit Lurkers, and walk away before the Spine hits them, but it takes too long. It's not worth your time to actually kill Lurkers with the Colossus.
It's pretty micro-intensive. It just because it works in theory doesn't mean that's what you want to do against this.
If both of you are out of minerals, and that's the situation, the Colossus player will win. But in a game like this, I don't think you're going to sit there and micro all day with two Colossus to kill seven Lurkers.
Oh, this is actually pretty good targeting. But hold on! Dark coming in here for a surround. Good angling. It looks like one of these Colossi will go down. Oh, wow. I'm not sure if there's enough overall here for Protoss to actually deal with that. A Dark exploding in supply, 143 to 118, with Lurkers here to push if he wants to. Although we don't see a fourth base here for Protoss. Zerg may, if he beats up any more of this army, he may want to do a counterattack here.
You know, I really do like a lot of things about Trust's play, but the fact that he just continually is trying to push against these lurkers, against this very good defensive comp when he's so stalker heavy. I like the running around, though, you know, trying to pick things off here and there. But any front-on fights are going to be a little bit difficult to win with this comp.
Keep in mind, this is the only Colossus we have in the game. If that's picked up, the Colossus tech just isn't there anymore. It's been Immortals and War Prisms coming out from here, which does change the Protoss's unit comp. And the ability to just do damage and try to initiate fights at a distance. The Lurkers are being relocated around here. Kind of reminding me, actually, of how we see a lot of PVZs in Brood War as well. This sort of mobile Lurker defense.
Since
about, let's say, like last year and a half, we've really seen people take advantage of Lurkers as great static defense that can be relocated.
Yeah.
And when I say static defense, I mean, I know that they can move still, but they can't move and attack. But you can set up a position and really make your opponent work hard to try to break it.
Ooh.
That was crazy. Yeah. Have we ever hit an object get that close to the screen?
That almost came out of the screen.
If we were
right
at
there.
SeaWorld, this would be in the splash section.
Anyone watching this on 4K just got a concussion. you know, he keeps pushing and, like, look, he's whittling some units down and stuff, but okay, he is getting his fourth up. That's good. He's got double Robo Immortals on the way. That's awesome. Templar Archives, Fleet Beacon. These are the types of things he needs to do. Like, I'm super happy to see him micro-ing some, as long as he's getting these other pieces behind, because his actual army doesn't really work anymore. He's going to need more splash damage. He's going to need more muscle. It's like Blink Stalkers and a Colossus, you know? Definitely needs more than that.
This is a cute little snipe here, taking out the Cybernetics core, especially when Protoss is pretty Stalker heavy. Now having this push come in here, which means the only Stalkers that aren't blinked away and kept alive are going to be the only ones remaining here. The Lurkers coming forward now. Still one Immortal in the back, unable to hit those Lurkers.
Oh, he's getting siege hard right now in his fourth base. That is going to end up going down, making more Immortals here. Oh, no, that is not what you want to do. Oh,
that was crazy how much of the army got shaved off. And it seems like Dark's actually going to double down with the push here. I think the second Robo is just outside of the third.
Yeah.
This War Prism is going to be easy for Dark to come in here and take out. Right now, Dark doubling the supply, literally, of Trust. We may have the killing blow coming up here in the next minute.
Trust doesn't have much of anything left over here. He's finally doing Prism Harassment, which is the actual counter to Lurker-based armies. But it's too little, too late. Dark has destroyed so much of his army, so much of his infrastructure, and this is going to be the game-ending move.
Yeah, this is where you right-click your army inside their base.
Yeah.
That is basically going to be it. Dark dominating Trust here in the second game. GG. And that does it for now, at least with these two. Assuming they don't face off in the final match. Dark goes on to the winner's match, and Trust, not being eliminated yet, has one more chance to prove himself in the loser's match before he is knocked out of the round of 32.
You know, I liked a lot of things about that game, about the way he played it. I think he dedicated too long on that attack that was Stalker-based against Lurker. When you see Lurker and you're on Blink Colossus, I mean, it's okay to poke at the edges and see if you can pick off a unit here and there, but expand, get your tech up, get into Prism, get into Charge, because, I mean, you can't fight Lurker-based armies head-on. It's, you know, you got to have, like, carriers or something. You can't do it.
Okay, we are going to take a short break. We come back, our second best of three, Trap versus Beyond in the GSL Codex. Don't tell me that you're